Hi everyone, today's session is on research tools for monitoring, the first part. Next week we also talk about some other stuff and go more into detail. And we will focus today on understanding reliability, validity and sensitivity, why they are so important when we talk about athlete monitoring. Today's session will be very crowded, I think, lots of content that we will cover. And first of all, before we go too much into the details, there will be a small spoiler, like I will provide you with some key take-home messages right at the beginning that you know what you will have to focus on within today's session. And hopefully this helps getting the, in general, a little bit complex and theoretical based topics to get a better understanding. So first of all, the topics are the constructs of reliability, validity, and sensitivity. They depend on the specific question that we ask, the context where we are set, and the measures that we use. All right, so I mentioned this before. There is no dichotomous answer or result to these constructs, like validity is not there or is absent, and validity is not there or absent, and same with sensitivity. It's always a question of how strong is it? Or how much can we say the quality is present or absent, all right? So it's never just a yes-no answer. It always depends on a different question. If I change the question, if I change the context, things could change right away. What we will cover today is that we briefly talk about what actually makes a good tool, a good monitoring tool. Then for today's session, I will give again a brief example of a study design. So that you have a specific context in mind where we talk about fatigue monitoring, acute fatigue monitoring. And within this context, we will discuss the concepts of reliability, validity, and sensitivity, basically. Then we will talk more into detail, and this is the biggest part about reliability, and it will also be the student talk on some measures of reliability in sports science. Afterwards, we talk about the constructs of validity and what is meant by the signal-to-noise ratio, and we will conclude with some take-home messages. So first of all, please let's brainstorm about what do you think makes a good monitoring tool. So there was also a study in rugby players from Starling and Lambert. And what the coaches and the practitioners responded, what is relevant for them to make a good monitoring tool, is that they get immediate feedback. Should be time efficient, so it shouldn't take too long to perform the tests, to perform the monitoring routine. So basically, if I talk about things every day, it's relevant that I only need 5 to 10 minutes, for example, that it's also possible to do it on a daily basis. Should be easy to administer, which you mentioned before, should be easy to perform, even if the staff changes, for example, or players are new. Should be inexpensive, either looking at inexpensive equipment and looking at human resources. So it shouldn't take too many people and it shouldn't be too expensive, because in most settings, most rehabilitation settings, most sports settings, we don't have enormous amounts of money. And if we think about having to collect data with a large group, we also need several devices, not just one device. Can be completed within with a whole team simultaneously, especially if we talk about large training groups, and even in individual sports, we probably have larger training groups, more than just one or two people. The measures should be, or the tools should try to be non-fatiguing. So often we are also interested in something like fatigue, or maybe something that could potentially in the future turn out to become an injury. And then it would not be good if we have a measure that introduces extra fatigue. Most of the time we want to see, like, what is the fatigue status, for example, and therefore measures should also try to be non-fatiguing and don't interfere too much with training, because if we do it in the beginning of training, we shouldn't have influences on the things that come afterwards. Most of the time people don't like invasive measures, so ideally it's non-invasive, although blood measures can provide some very useful information. Tools should be reliable, valid, and sensitive to change. And although I said this in the beginning, all these things are context-dependent, question-dependent, and measure-dependent, at least. This is what we focus on today. To better get an understanding of how can we quantify this more continuously, not just say yes or no. It's sensitive, it's valid, it's reliable. How much, in which context, to which question? So making the scene, what is the example for today's session? And again, this is something that appears again and again, the Reckman study, where we looked at high intensity training or very demanding training for a microcycle of 6 consecutive days of overload training. We tested performance before and after the microcycle, where people should be fatigued quite substantially during training. And there was also a follow-up testing during recovery, but we only focus on pre- to post-intervention testing, where athletes should be fatigued at the post-1 testing. Within this study, this was a larger study, also as mentioned before, with different conditions, endurance-based training, strength-based training, and high-intensity interval training, with three different parallel groups. And within all the different study contexts, we used performance, sport-specific performance or training-specific performance as a criterion measure. So we defined fatigue as if the criterion measured criterion performance decreased, then we have fatigue. Then the fatigue is substantial enough that also sport performance is decreased. And then we used a lot of surrogate measures, something like, for example, my focus of interest, heart rate measures, but also submaximal performance measures, bloodborne measures, psychometrics, and other measures. If they are able to monitor, to track the fatigue response and the performance measure during the training. That was the main idea, and this will all the examples be. And if we put this into the context of the Jeffries model, we talk about, when we talk about fatigue monitoring, basically acute negative effects within this microcycle. And we also, when we talk about sport performance, criterion performance, it could also be performance-related measures depending on functional overreaching. Right? This is what we talk about today, where we talked about the concepts of reliability, validity, and sensitivity. So we will start with reliability, and there are also lots of other terms that are related to this concept. So we sometimes also say it's repeatability, reproducibility, replicability, agreement, accuracy, consistency, or precision of a measure. And the other way around, we could also talk about measurement error or noise. So all these terms are relevant, or often all these terms are meant if we talk about reliability. And again, a quick brainstorming. What sources of variability or error do you know? Why could a measure be less reliable? Which sources of variability happen, and which types of reliability do you know of? So I also made a brief list of what sources of variability could be present. So for example, we could talk about different devices, like if we have 2 heart rate measuring devices, for example, who tells us if these devices don't measure differently? Even if it's the same brand, who knows? We could also talk about different test methods. So also, do I look at a jump test based on a counter movement jump with the hands on the hips, or if I'm looking at jump and reach test, different subjects could be a source of variability. So either looking at different athletes or different subjects, or looking at different raters because they do have different levels of expertise. Learning effects and familiarization could be an effect of variability or error that we don't want to have. Also the warm-up and a warm-up before the test, fatigue during the tests, other surrounding conditions like lifestyle, pre-test routine could have an impact on the reliability of a tool, biological variability, whatever this might be, like circadian rhythm and so on and so far. So things that change over day from a day-to-day basis. And we also hear the term random error. So sources of variability that we cannot explain by other things, just variability that happens without any explanation. And we have different types of reliability. So for example, we can separate between measures of absolute and relative reliability. As mentioned before, we have test-retest reliability, and then we can separate between from trial-to-trial variation, but also between days, between weeks. Inter-device reliability, inter-rater reliability, which is also often called objectivity. Intra-rater reliability, so the same person doing things several times. How consistent is the rater? We also have measures of bias and agreement. And what we also focus on very much today is the standard or the typical error of measurement. And if we look at different measures of reliability, how can we try to quantify how reliable is a tool? Here's a case example, which you could also find in the first Excel sheet if you want to follow right away, but we can do this afterwards. So for example, in the study, we had a baseline period where there were 4 days of measurement before the initial pretest. And we just look at baseline day 1 and 2 in heart rate measures. So for example, the first subject had an average heart rate in this supine recording, like in a lying position, of 56.9 beats per minute. And the second day, it was 55.7. And we take all the different measures from the different athletes in the study and make a correlation. So we plot the first day versus the second day and calculate a measure of relative reliability, the Pearson's R, the Pearson correlation. And it could look like this. So for example, on the x-axis, we see the heart rate measure of the first day and plot this against, on the y-axis, the heart rate measure on the second day. We perform a, or we create a scatter plot, draw a linear fit, and calculate the correlation, basically. In this case, we have a correlation of almost 0.8, which is not too bad, but in terms of reliability, it's also not too good. So we could look at the Pearson's correlation between day 1 and day 2 measures. A better way is usually to calculate intra-class correlations, and there are different ways, as you can see, like depending on the author, we have at least 6 or 10 different versions of calculating intra-class correlation. Basically, what an intra-class correlation does is we perform some kind of association between day 1 and day 2, but we can also account for different sources of variability. Pearson correlation can be very high, even if there's a strong systematic bias. Intra-class correlation, depending on the different version, can handle it a little bit better. So usually it's recommended to calculate intra-class correlation, but you have to be aware there are lots of different variations, lots of different versions of intra-class correlation, and you have to specify which version you calculate. Otherwise, it's not good and it's not easy to interpret your results. Another way of how we can look at test retest reliability on a day-to-day basis, and also the test retest setting is the thing that is most important for us in our context. We could also look at the difference on a day-to-day basis. So for the first subject, there was a difference of -1 beat per minute. In the third subject, we had +7 beats per minute from day 1 to day 2. So we could look at the differences between day 1 and day 2. If we look at the differences, we usually talk about absolute reliability. So how much variation was there in the original unit in beats per minute between day 1 and day 2. And the first thing is we can look at the bias. And bias means that we look at the average difference from day 1 and day 2. So we use the differences for the individual athletes. So the differences between 1 and day 2 on the y-axis, and we plot them against the average value from the athlete. And the average difference between day 1 and day 2, the bias, is 0.5 beats per minute. So on the second day, on average, athletes had 0.5 beats per minute higher heart rate than on the first day. And this is the bias. We can also calculate develop basically limits of agreement. Like, we not just look at the average difference, we look at the range of differences that were observed. And the limits of agreement, as you can see on the left plot, ranges between -8 beats per minute and +9 beats per minute. So everything between -8 beats per minute and +9 beats per minute could be plausible based on the data that we observed. And the limits of agreement approximately include 95% of the differences that we observe if the data is normally distributed. Basically, what we do is we calculate it like this. So we look at the bias as a starting point, and then we take the standard deviation of the differences and multiply them by approximately 2. So basically, limits of agreement is 2 times the standard deviation of the differences, and this approximately equates to 95% of the differences that we observe, or that we expect to observe if we have a large sample and if we have normally distributed data. Measure of absolute reliability. We could also And this is the most important context or concept that we talk about today, express the differences between day one and day two as a standard error of measurement. And what we do then is we take the we look at the differences here, and you see compared to the limits of agreement, the range of the standard error of measurement is smaller. And the range of the standard of error of measurement in this case is 3 beats per minute. And what does this standard error of measurement tell us? It tells us that approximately 50% of the differences are in there. So not 90% of the differences are plus minus 3 beats per minute, but only 50% of the differences. But if we look at the reliability of a single measure, so if I measure heart rate once per day and I have a standard error of measurement of 3 beats per minute, this value tells me that on any given day, if I collect heart rate data typically varies between plus and minus 3 beats per minute. And so therefore, if I'm only talking about one measurement, I know that approximately 2/3 of the measurements are within the standard error of measurement. So on a day-to-day basis, I would expect that 2 of 3 measures would vary within 3 beats per minute. So it's really easy to calculate this. We look at the standard deviation of the differences, but divide them by the square root of 2, because we expect that we have a measurement error on the first day and we have a measurement error on the second day. So if we look at the differences are comprised the measurement error from the day one and day two. So the measurement error for the difference is always higher than for a single measurement, because for the difference, we need at least 2 measures. And therefore, we have measurement in both errors. And to account for this, we separate or divide by the standard, by the square root of 2. Another measure that is extremely common in sports science is to express the standard error of measurement as a coefficient of variation. To be clear, a coefficient of variation always is a percentage value, a percentage variability. And this variability could be anything. It could be a typical between subject standard deviation. It could be a measure standard error of measurement. So coefficient of variation only means some type of variability expressed in percent. But in terms of reliability, we most often say the coefficient of variation is the standard error of measurement in percent. In this case, the 3% resting heart rate variability on a day-to-day basis is equal to 5% day-to-day variation in resting heart rate. So what we can do is we take the standard error of measurement and divide this by the average heart rate. Then we get a percentage value. Finally, there's another approach if we have repeated measures. So for example, as I mentioned before, we had 4 days of baseline recording for the heart rates. And we can also look at variability within a subject expressed as a standard deviation. So we can look at for athlete one, measurement 1, measurement 2, measurement 3, measurement 4, calculate the standard deviation, the individual standard deviation of each athlete, which I expressed in this line. And then we just take the average standard deviation, the average individual standard deviation. This is another approach. If we have more than 2 measures from individuals, if we have 4 to 10 measures, for example, for an individual, we could also calculate the within subject standard deviation and make an average of the entire group. This is also possible, and in this case, it's also 3 beats per minute, average within subject standard deviation, but this way of calculation is not recommended, because if we have different days, it's very difficult to control for different situations. So it could be that there are training effects from day 1 to day 4, that there are fatigue effects, that the environmental conditions or psychological state of an athlete changes. So it's really difficult to have comparable situations in repeated measures. So I would not recommend using this equation, because it's so difficult to control the circumstances, to control the situations for the different athletes. So really quickly, I introduced a couple of measures, how we could express reliability in relative terms and absolute terms. So we can calculate types of correlations, and we can look at the day-to-day differences if we talk about test-retest reliability. And most of the time we use some measures of standard deviation, so the typical variation on a day-to-day basis in the differences. This is the most important thing. And this is what we call measurement error or standard error of measurement, or sometimes typical error of measurement. To understand what a measurement error actually is, I know these equations are very theoretical and difficult to understand, so this is why we would go through some examples. We have to know the basic underlying concept is, if we take a measure in practice, the measurement does not represent the truth. The measured score, the things that we observe, is based on the true score, so what the athlete actually has, plus measurement error. So we are never able to observe the truth, to observe what the athlete actually looks like today. We can only take some measurements, and measurements always comprise also measurement error. So what does it mean? The true score would be a hypothetical value that I can collect from an athlete if there was no measurement error present. Measurement error could be things like instrumentation, biological noise, other sources of variation that we talked about earlier. And the measured score is basically the true score plus measurement error. This is the basic understanding of if we take a measurement in practice, if we monitor, for example. And we expect the following situation. So in the beginning, in the middle, we have something like a true score. An athlete has, for example, a specific jump ability. For example, an athlete is able to jump 40 centimeters, and this is the true score. And then we take some measurements, and we would expect that the measures we take of this athlete with a jump height of 40 centimeters would have measured values that distribute normally around the true score. So for example, we have an athlete with a true jump height of 40 centimeters, and we have a test, a counter movement jump test, with a standard error of measurement of 2 centimeters. And then we would expect within plus minus one standard error of measurement, like between 38 centimeters and 42 centimeters, that most of the jumps would be expected in this area if this athlete has a true jump height of 40 centimeters. And if we look at two standard deviations, like 95% of the time, 95% of the measurements that I would observe with an athlete of 40 centimeters would fall within 36 centimeters and 44 centimeters. So based around the true score that we never know, the observed scores, the measurements would distribute normally. This is the basic assumption of what we think about today and what we will look at more into detail in a second. So what we will do to try to understand measurement error, we are going to run some simulations in Excel. I will introduce what we will do, and then you can run them on your own and get some experience to understand what measurement error is if we simulate data. Again, this concept we talk about, we use data from this fatigue monitoring study, basically from Timo's study where we had counter movement jump, where counter movement jump changed over time, but we'll go more into detail later on. And we had an average jump height for the males in our study of 41.5 centimeters at the pretest, and this is the basic starting point that we have. And in this study, we had a standard error of measurement of almost two centimeters. All right, so basic task, what we will do now, we go to the Excel file, we will run some simulations to see and understand what does it mean if an athlete has a jump height of approximately 40 centimeters, and if we observe a measurement error of approximately 2 centimeters. All right, so please open the spreadsheet that I mentioned before. So we use the Excel sheet, understand, what was the name again? There, understand, rely, valid, sense class. And we go to the second worksheet. All right, so please everyone open the spreadsheet and go to the second worksheet. You can then decide if you want to follow my screen and want to follow the things that I'm doing, or the things that I ask you to do are also displayed down here, the different tasks, and we go from task 1 to task 6, if we have enough time, and run some different simulations, all right, to see and to try to understand what I'm actually talking about. So what this spreadsheet does, and I will make this a little bit bigger, is here we define what we want to simulate. So we expect, to make it a little bit easier, I chose 40 centimeters instead of 41.5 centimeters because it's just an easier value. So we expect that we have an athlete with a true jump height of 40 centimeters. And we have a counter movement jump are where the measurement error is 1.86, right? So what would happen in reality if I make a measurement of this athlete? This is what we can see in this figure and what is calculated here, like the different measured scores. And now if we press F9, you can see this here in the first tag, if we press F9, we can see what would happen if I measure an athlete different times. So each time I press F9, I would observe, or I would be able to collect a measurement based on the assumption that the athlete has a true jump height of 40 centimeters and that I have a measurement error of 2 centimeters. All right. So also do this again, either follow my screen or do this on your own and press F9 10 to 20 times and see what happens with the measured scores if I repeat the test again and again. In the meantime, if you have any questions, just ask me. All right. So what we see is the measures vary from trial to trial. Of course, if an athlete would jump several times and there would be no fatigue, I would expect different measures. Sometimes I see very high measures, way larger than 40 centimeters. Sometimes I would see also measures that are below the average. It just depends. To understand this a little bit better, you can now go to the table here where there's the small blue triangle, and you can drag it down until we have 10 measures or 30 measures, it doesn't matter. So we would then observe in the figure 10 to 13 measured jump heights right away. All right, we don't have to look at one jump height at the moment, we can look at 10 jump heights directly. And we would see that if we look at more jumps, that they fall around plus or minus the true score, like the true jump height of 40 centimeters. And what I also displayed here in the lines is the dashed line, one standard deviation above and below the true score, two standard deviations, and 2.5 standard deviations, basically. All right. So we can also simulate this. If we take 10 measurements of this athlete, how would we expect the measures to change over time? If I just select random measures of this athlete. And these are the things that we would expect to observe in reality. It could be either of those. So if I take this measurement, I would say, okay, maybe the athlete has a jump height of approximately 36 centimeters. If I take this measurement, maybe it would be 43, but in reality, we know in this simulation, the true jump height is only 40 centimeters, but we have 2 centimeters of measurement error. This is what would happen if we measure in practice and we don't know the true value. So in the third task, and you can play around with that, go to the cell A5 and play around with the measurement error. For example, make a measurement error of 3 centimeters and see what happens with the variation within the measure, right? Try to simulate some data with a higher measurement error. Try to simulate a measure with a very low measurement error and see what happens with the observed scores. All right. Please try this out and raise your hand if you performed a couple of simulations with a higher measurement error or a lower measurement error compared to the things that we observed in the study. So the next thing what we do is we do this lots of time. Like we drag and drop the simulation, the table down until we reach something like 1,000 replications. Oops. So 1,000 replications. So if we would be able to directly see what happens if I do this 1,000 of times, poor athlete, how would the data distribute around the true score? So what we see here is for the theoretical situation, for the theoretical situation that I would be able to observe thousands of different trials from an athlete with a jump height of 40 centimeters, a true jump height of 40 centimeters and a measurement error of 2. On the right-hand side, you now see an informative distribution and histogram of the jump height. So we do see what I coded in simulation, that a measurement error is normally distributed. And we see how the different values, how the different measurements would look like. And again, this is the fourth task. Again, what we also do is we now change the measurement error. For example, we increase measurement error. What happens then? We decrease measurement error. What happened to the measured scores? And I believe that this is a very impressive way of understanding what happens if I have high or low measurement error, because you always have to imagine when I perform a test in practice, which has measurement error of 2 centimeters, and if I have an athlete of 40 centimeters jump height, true jump height, I would observe one of these data points. A data point could be like this, a data point could be like this. It's most likely that it's more or less around the true jump height, but it could also be a jump height like this. And we also always have to ask ourselves, if I have one measurement, if I have one observation, is this an observation from an athlete with a true jump height of 40 centimeters? Or is this a jump height of an athlete with 34 centimeters? Both are plausible. And if I only have one measurement, I cannot tell, because it's impossible to tell if this is a measurement below the true score or higher than the true score. If I only have a couple of measurements, it's impossible to detect what was actually the true score in the background of this athlete. So every time we test, we only see one of these data points. If we test several times, it may get a little bit better, but if we only test a couple of times, it could be that I'm extremely misrepresenting the true value of the athlete. And this is a really important point. So we go back to the presentation, and I hope that this helped slightly to understand what's happening. If we think about measurement error, we always have to have something like this in mind. If we do different tests, we would expect that the measured scores vary quite substantially, and they vary depending on the measurement error. And the higher the measurement error, the more problems I have if I want to define an individual athlete's test score with only a couple of measures. This is the most important point here. We always have to imagine we're only looking at it with one measurement. We're only looking at one of these data points. All right. So part of the homework or the follow-up should be that you can use the data sets that are uploaded to analyze the different types of reliability from different measures. So for example, you could look at the heart rate data from my study, where we have four baseline recordings, where you could calculate the different types of reliability to understand what is happening. And the spreadsheet, the first working sheet, performs all the different analysis there. You can just look at the values, the outcomes. And I would also highly recommend that you run some simulations with measured scores of your interest. So for example, you could either use Timo or my study and the data there. For example, again, look at the different performance tests like one RM in a back squat or repeated sprint ability. We have the different measures here. You can plot in or put in different performance measures and typical error of measurements. And you can play around with this to understand which tool might be useful or not, depending on reliability. So now let's talk about validity. And although we are a little bit behind time, I still want to use the time to get you brainstorming. So what do you think, or what is reliability or validity for you, and which types of validity do you know of? So to repeat, validity is the degree to which the measure Validity is the degree to which the test measures what its purpose to measure. Can the test answer, help me answer the question? That's the main idea, the main definition of validity. And of course, it depends on the purpose. So do I want to discriminate and or evaluate performance? And it depends on the application. So am I looking for research, or am I looking for routine practice, for monitoring in practice? The surroundings, the requirements are different. Types of validity, we can talk about construct validity, or also convergent and divergent validity. Construct validity is also sometimes used as an overarching term for all types of validity. So not perfect definition, but basically, do I measure the construct that I'm interested in appropriately? And all the different types of validity sometimes help to understand or to grasp this construct validity. There is something like face validity. So basically, the appearance to the non-expert, the appearance, does this test is appropriate for the perception of the athlete, for the perception of the coach, for the perception of the practitioner. Content or logical validity is basically, is it an appropriate tool based on expert assessment? Do the expert believe this is a valid test? Internal versus external or ecological validity. So basically, internal validity is present if I'm really specifically able to describe or measure a physiological response. If I want to understand a physiological response in a lab, this is always the best context. But external validity is if I'm measuring in the field, if I'm able to generalize my results out of the field. So for example, I'm able to control the circumstances in a laboratory quite well, and I'm good to get mechanistic understanding, but it's really difficult to put this into practice. What happens if the temperature changes? What happens if there are different surrounding factors? What happens if I have contact with another athlete, for example? And so also external and internal validity are in contrast to each other. So basically lab versus field. Criterion validity, we can separate between predictive, concurrent, and postdictive validity there. And longitudinal validity, external responsiveness, or also sensitivity to change. And we will focus on criterion validity and longitudinal validity. And I will go into detail what this means in a second. So basically, criterion validity does mean I have a criterion measure. For example, in our case, the repeated sprint ability test. Repeated sprint ability test for the high intensity interval training group was the criterion performance. This is what is important for high intensity training. Performing repeated sprints. So basically, if we want to evaluate the validity of a counter movement jump test, is this associated with the performance in a repeated sprint ability test? Does counter movement jump predict repeated sprint ability test performance? And can it discriminate between good and bad athletes? What we do is, for example, we can look at the pre-test scores for the different athletes and can say, okay, this athlete jumped 26 centimeters high, and his or her repeated sprint ability test performance was an average maximum speed of 4.1 meters per second. So basically, we can calculate the correlation between the performance values in the first test against the second test. So we compare the surrogate measure, the measure of interest, the monitoring tool, compared to the criterion measure. This is what we are interested in. We want to predict counter movement jump. We want to predict repeated sprint ability test from counter movement jump. We want to use them interseparately. This is criterion performance, criterion validity on a discriminative level. So do the athletes who perform well in counter movement jump also perform well in the repeated sprint ability test. A specific case of criterion validity is the longitudinal validity, which we also often call sensitivity or responsiveness or external responsiveness. And what is relevant there when we think about the monitoring context, it's not only interesting if counter movement jump performance predicts repeated sprint ability test, but if my performance in the counter movement jump changes, does the repeated sprint ability performance change as well? So if I observe a change in one measure, is this associated with the change in the criterion measure? And what we can do in the studies, for example, when we look at pre-testing, post-testing, in respect or in response to fatigue, we can look at average changes. So the counter movement jump changed, the performance dropped in both groups, in the male group and the female group. So we had a significant time effect. There were some average changes from the from pre-test to post-test. And this was similar to the repeat sprint ability test. So people were fatigued in both tests. But if we calculate the correlation between the changes in counter movement jump height and in repeated sprint ability test, we observed an trivial and unclear correlation. So yes, there was a change in the average score, but the changes in counter movement jump were not related to the changes in repeated sprint ability test. So we had a good validity in respect to the better an athlete is in counter movement jump, the better he or she is in repeated sprint ability test, but the change in counter movement jump was not related to the change in repeated sprint ability test. Right, so the sensitivity, sensitivity was present because we had a change in means, but the external responsiveness is not present. External responsiveness, does the change in counter movement jump predict the change in repeated sprint ability test? And this was not present in the study. We can also look at sensitivity in another way. We can do this categorically, like not say the higher the counter movement jump, the higher the repeated sprint ability test, but we can say, for example, was there a change in counter movement jump? And at the same time, was there a change in repeated sprint ability test? And we can do this by the thing called diagnostic sensitivity analysis or diagnostic accuracy analysis. So basically, we use cutoff values. For example, a typical measurement, the typical error of measurement. So for example, we look at all the athletes, all the 22 athletes in the study, and we look at repeated sprint ability test. Some athletes show a positive response, so they were fatigued after overload training. 50 athletes showed reduced repeated sprint ability test at the post-test, and 7 did not. And we can look at the same time at the measures in the counter movement jump. Did the counter movement jump decrease? So was there a fatigue response? This happened in 19 athletes. And were there not a fatigue response? This happened in 3 athletes. So we have 4 different cases. We have the criterion measure is positive, fatigue and criterion measure, and fatigued in the surrogate measure, and so on and so forth. So we have truth positives. Both tests were positive. False positive. My monitoring measurement said, yes, athlete was fatigued, but in reality, he was not. False negative. The counter movement jump test said there was no fatigue, but there was. True negative is both tests said, yes, athlete was not fatigued, and counter movement jump also said was not fatigued. And based on these 4 cases, we can calculate different things, like, for example, the sensitivity in this sense is the true positive rate. So 13 of all athletes, 87% of the athletes who were fatigued were also detected by the counter movement jump test. So sensitivity is the true positive rate. There are also other things like specificity, the true negative rate, positive predictive value, which is also relevant. If I only know the counter movement jump performance, how many times was the counter movement jump performance correct? And this is only 68%. We have negative predictive value. If I have a negative test in the surrogate measure, how often is this correct? Only 33%. We can look at accuracy, diagnostic effectiveness, and we can look at misclassification rates. So different ways of analyzing all the things related to sensitivity and accuracy if we use clear cutoffs. If we say fatigued, non-fatigued in measure A and measure B. These are the things that are also happening very often in health settings. So for example, in COVID situation, is there an infection? Yes or no? Does the PCR test detect this infection? Yes or no? This is where we can calculate the different things, sensitivity, specificity, positive and negative predictive values, and so on and so forth. So we have to have an understanding that sensitivity can also mean a very specific thing when we talk about diagnostic accuracy, if we have clear cutoff values, sick or non-sick, infected, non-infected. Does the test reach a certain cutoff value or not? So different types of looking at sensitivity. The most important thing, and Philip touched this quite briefly in the beginning, is that we always have to understand the things in context. And this is where the signal-to-noise ratio comes into play. So what does this mean is we talk about the signal, the things, the changes I would expect in athletes and patients that typically happen or that are meaningful. So for example, if I go into an overload training camp, if I perform 6 days of very demanding training, what is the average response, the average fatigue that I expect from the athletes? How much does counter movement jump drops within 6 days of training, right? This can be the signal. At the same time, we need to evaluate what is the measurement error of this testing device of the counter movement jump. And does the typical change, the signal that I expect, is larger or lower than the measurement error? And I only have a good monitoring tool if the signal is larger than the noise. The changes that I'm interested in, if they are larger than the measurement noise. Otherwise, I have a problem. So for example, the average heart rate in the strength training group, in this overload study, in this fatigue study was, in the beginning, average heart rate of 60 beats per minute. Resting heart rate increased at the pole test by 4 beats per minute. And we had a measurement error of 3. So basically, the signal increase of resting heart rate by 4 beats per minute compared to a measurement error of 3. So yeah, maybe it's okay. Maybe the signal to noise ratio is a little bit positive, but it's really close to being irrelevant. In the high intensity interval training group, same thing, standing heart rate recordings, standing heart rate decreased by 8 beats per minute. I had a measurement error of 6 beats per minute. So for the standing heart rate measures, the signal to noise ratio was a little bit more appropriate. If I'm interested in changes, in fatigue changes over a week, over a microcycle week, then I have a good signal to noise ratio for this situation, for this measurement. All right, the measurement error is lower than the signal that I'm interested in. Another example from Timo's study, if we look at the other measures, counter movement jump performance decreased in response to fatigue by 3 beats per minute. We know 3 centimeters, measurement error was 2 centimeters. So good signal to noise ratio, same with multiple rebound jumps, same with 20 meter sprint. So the signal to noise ratio for the submaximal performance tests were quite okay in respect to the average signal that I expect in response to fatigue overload training cycle. All right. This is the signal to noise ratio. And the final thing we want to touch today, or I want to introduce you today, is to give you a better understanding of why reliability is so important for validity. We understood how we can make sense of measurement error if we think of replicated values, measured values from a true score. And what we do now, I quickly run some simulations on, we have observed test scores and define them as true test scores. And what does it mean? So for example, we take this correlation that we observed before, and this of course was based on the measures that we did, but we now say, okay, we run a simulation. This is the true population value. We now assume that this athlete in reality has this jump height and this repeated sprint ability test. All right, we now say the measured scores are reality. We now say this is what our starting point, this is what reality looks like. And we now look what happens if we introduce measurement error. If we perform a study and we have the measurement error that was described in the study, what happens then? So again, quickly opening the Excel workbook, and we are on worksheet 4. We expect that the values from the study, wait, I'll make this a little bit larger. We expect the values of the studies are reality, and then we add to this measurement error. And the measurement error is displayed in error bars. So the horizontal lines is the measurement error in counter movement jump, and the vertical lines is the measurement error in repeated sprint ability test. And again, if we run simulations on the right-hand side, you can see the observed scores, the observed measurements that we take, and always the correlations. In reality, we have a correlation of 0.81. And here you can see the correlation if we have a measurement error as described in the study. 0.1 meters per second for repeated sprint ability test and almost 2 centimeters for the counter movement jump. And what do we see is, of course, with each study that we take, which each study where there's measurement error, we observe one specific kind of variability, one specific kind of correlation. Sometimes correlations is higher, sometimes correlations are lower, but quite often the validity between the two tests would be lower than the validity in reality. Measurement error reduces the criterion validity. Now let's take a look what happens if I increase the measurement error. So for example, if I double the measurement error for the counter movement jump, if I have a poorer counter movement jump measure, you can see here the error bars from the original values is larger. What happens to the correlations? The correlations even get lower. The validity correlations even get lower. There's a lower validity and a less reliable counter movement jump measure. And if we also double the measurement error in the repeated sprint ability test, so if both measures are less reliable than before, the observed correlation, the observed validity correlations even get worse. All right, if I'm interested in criterion validity, I have a problem when measurement error is high. And the higher the measurement error, the less reliable the tools get. Because there is random variability with each test, and therefore I'm not able to observe the true correlation between the two measurements. Even if they would be related in theory, I cannot measure them because my testing tools are too unreliable. So really quickly, measurement error. If I introduce measurement error, validity correlation between observed scores get lower. If I increase the measurement error, correlations get lower. If I further increase the measurement error, correlation gets lower. That's the basic idea. I have a problem if I do a study and I have high measurement error, then I'm not able to interpret criterion validity as it would be in reality if I have a perfect measurement of the different concepts, right? Jump performance, is this related to repeated sprint ability test? To answer this question, respect to criterion validity, I need good measurement tools. I need very reliable measurement tools. Otherwise, reliability affects validity directly. All right? Take home messages. I repeat this from the beginning. So I hope it was a little bit more clear based on the things we talked about today, that reliability, validity, and sensitivity depend on the specific question, the specific context, and the measures. There are no dichotomous results, like it's not there or it's absent. And it's very, very important for practical situations where we're only interested in single athletes and a couple of measurements that there's a positive signal to noise ratio. The signal that we are interested in should be larger than the measurement error. Otherwise, we have a problem. How we could solve this problem, we will also talk about next week, which tricks based on study design, based on analysis, do we have to make this situation a little bit more optimistic, a little bit better. But this is the topic for next session. And the final thing is, if we hopefully understood that measurement error is so crucial to be able to understand what happens at an individual athlete and also to understand things like criterion validity, we need to make sure that that measurement error is low. And how could we reduce measurement error? For example, we could try to use consistent and adequate warm-up before the test. We should use consistent instructions and verbal encouragements. If different coaches or scientists perform the tests, we should be consistent. We should try to test at the same time of the day if we're looking at changes over time, because there could be a variation there. We should try to keep the environmental conditions as similar as possible or even the same. So ideally, it's always optimal to reduce measurement error if we are indoors. And if this is not possible, we try to at least record the different environmental conditions to make sense of this afterwards. Maybe it's related to a different temperature. Maybe it's related to different humidity. We definitely need plenty of familiarization to reduce learning effects. So people subjects, athletes, clients should be familiarized with the trials. Otherwise, I introduce unnecessary error. We should try to standardize the pre-monitoring routines. Also try to standardize the conditions if I want to look at changes from day one to day two, nutrition, sleep, training, if possible. And this is what we focus on next week. We can also try to collect more data. So for example, we can try to use repeated measures per assessment, or we could use repeated testing during intervention period. So not just look once pre, once post intervention, but using repeated measures. We can also try to replicate the intervention to get a better understanding, did the athlete respond or not? All use replicated crossovers. Also give some examples next week. Or we could use other types of single subject designs, which help us to better understand what actually happens at an individual. How could we deal with measurement error? And again, as the follow-up tasks, I would highly recommend that you use Excel spreadsheets to run the analysis for yourself using different measures and run the simulations for yourself using different measures to better understand what we actually did. All the spreadsheets are prepared that you can directly look at the results. So you don't have to calculate this your own, but you could put in different starting values. So like not just looking at the reliability from resting heart rate in a supine position, you could look at reliability measures for the standing heart rate, for heart rate variability. This is where we have data. This is where I provided you with data for different measures, where you can look at how do the results, how do the analysis work, how is the day-to-day reliability in the different measures, and compare this to the things that I reported in the study. You could also run some simulation with the different tests, as I mentioned before. Like you can look at run one repetition maximum in a back squat. You can look at repeated sprint ability test based on the measurement errors that are reported. How would I expect measures to vary if I perform them in practice? And you can also run some validity analysis to look at the different measures in the study, like did heart rate correlate with endurance test performance, the changes in heart rate correlate with changes in endurance test performance, and so on and so far. So all the data is there, all the analysis is there. I believe running the analysis based on the prepared spreadsheets can help you get a better understanding of what we're actually doing when we try to analyze this. So this is my very high recommendation, that you try to recapitulate this and put in some other data to see what is happening. So thank you very much for listening, and I'm open for questions.